So let us continue the discussion on the topic of scope of supply. We have been discussing section 7 for the past 3 days, which deals with what items are included in supply. Within section 7, subsection 1, clause A, clause B, clause C are there. We have discussed clause A, clause B, and the discussion has been going on for the past 2 days on clause C. In clause C, there are 4 activities which are mentioned in Schedule 1 of the Act, where even if there is no consideration, still the activities or transactions will be treated as supply. Out of those 4 activities, I have covered with you 3 activities already. First activity was permanent disposal of assets on which ITC has been availed, that I have covered. Second was transfer of goods or services between, supply of goods or services between related persons. That has also been covered, or distinct persons. Third activity in Schedule 1 is supply of goods between principal and agent, where agent is acting on behalf of the principal. And now let us discuss last and the fourth activity of Schedule 1. After this, my section 7 subsection 1 will be over, and I will start with section 7 subsection 1A. So let me share with you the Bayer Act. And let me show you the last activity of Schedule 1. After this, our section 7 subsection 1 will be completely over. Let me discuss the language of the Act. Fourth activity, then I will start simplifying that. This is my fourth and last activity of Schedule 1. What it says now? Import of services by a person. Import of services. Now, if you see the word import of services, see the sentence, or you can say, see these 3 words, import of services. It has already been used in Section 7, Subsection 1, Clause B. I will show you now. Import of services by a person from a related person or from any of his other establishments outside India in the course or furtherance of business. This is the last activity of Schedule 1. So let me now simplify this for you. So still the discussion is going on scope of supply. Within scope of supply, if you remember, we have section 7.1A already discussed, 7.1B already discussed, and we were discussing 7.1C. Within 7.1C, we have to take the help of Schedule 1. Within Schedule 1, there are 4 different activities. Activity 1, Activity 2, Activity 3, Activity 4, and my discussion today is on Activity 4. Now, what this Activity 4 says? Import of services. By whom? By a person. From whom? From a related person. Or another establishment, of this person, which person? This person who is importing outside India. import of services by a person from a related person or from another establishment of this person outside India, even if without consideration, even if there is no consideration, it's free, even if free, but business point of view is must. Business compulsion is must. Then that is also treated as supply. So I will assume some examples now for you, and you have to try to tell me. Example number one, Mr. X or Mrs. X, Delhi. She has availed the services from Mr. John, Australia, interior designer. She has availed the services for her personal house. For personal house, she has imported some services from Mr. John and paid, for example, $5 lakhs. My question is it a supply? Can you tell me, is it a supply or not? That's it. Can anyone tell me, is it a supply or not? Availing these services from Mr. John, who is in Australia, for my personal house and giving him $5 lakh, is it a supply or not? This is my question. Is it a supply or not? Anyone who can try to tell me, is it a supply or not? How will you tell whether it is a supply or not? Whenever you have to take a decision of supply or not, you must be having one thing only in mind, section 7, subsection 1, 3 clauses. Now, is it a supply under clause A? Answer is not. Because in clause A, the condition, one of the condition is business requirement, which is not meeting here, because I am availing the services for my personal house. So it is not a supply under 1A. No issue. We have to check 1B. Now, if you remember 1B, that is also import of services. I don't know whether you remember it or not, but that is also import of services where you can import the services. Consideration is must. With consideration, consideration is must. I don't know whether you remember it or not. Consideration is must. Business or personal doesn't matter. Business or personal doesn't matter. So in my case, I'm meeting the criteria of 7.1b because I'm importing a services with consideration, even if personal doesn't matter. My answer is, it is a supply. It is a supply. Under section 7, subsection 1, clause B. That's it. So why will I check 7.1c? There is no need to bother about all the clauses. The main thing is something must be supplied. And these are three different clauses given. Wherever your case fits in, that's over. If something has become supplied, then why there is a need to check all other clauses? So though I was discussing with you 7.1c, but I gave this example in such a way that 7.1b can be applied. So why will I bother about 7.1c? No, there is no need to check 7.1c. If this thing has become a supply, then it is a supply under 7.1b. There is no problem. Please raise your hand if this point is clear. I am meeting the criteria of 7.1b, and that's it. Please raise your hand if you know or if you remember that yes, it is a supply under 7.1b. Okay, now let us make a change in this example. Let us make a small change in this example. Same example, I'll make only one change. let us make a small change. Example 2. Continuing the same example. Now, what change I will make? Okay, let us make one change that no consideration is involved. Only one change. Same example, no consideration is given to Mr. John. No consideration is given to Mr. John. Now, can you tell me now, is it a supply or not? That's it. This is my question. Again, my question is it a supply or not? Answer. I have made only one change that this consideration will be missing now. There is no consideration. So the consideration is missing. Now with this, can anyone tell me whether it is a supply or not?
Sir, not a supply.
Not a supply, why?
Sir, so there is no consideration as well as it is personal, so not a supply.
Okay, any other answer? Any other answer? Any other answer? So how will I check whether it is a supply or not? Again, the sequence must be same. Is it a supply under 7-1A? Always check in this way. Is it a supply under 7-1A? Answer is no. Because in 7-1A, consideration is also one of the conditions which is missing. So it's not a supply in 7-1A. Is it a supply under 7-1B? Is it import of services? Yes. Is it business or personal? Doesn't matter. But is there any consideration? No, because in 7-1B also consideration is required. So it's not a supply under 7-1B also. Still, I cannot decide. I have 7-1C also. In 7-1C, there are four activities. If you remember, permanent disposal, which is not there. Supply of goods between related persons or distinct persons, which is not there. Principal agent, which is not there in my example. So what is last one left? So what is fourth activity left? What is fourth activity left? Is it is import of services? Answer is yes. It's an import of services. Okay, next issue. Is it without consideration? It can be without consideration. Answer is yes. Can be without consideration. Answer is yes. And what you remember? Another condition in fourth one, it should be between related persons. So the information is missing whether Mr. John and Mrs. X is related or not. But I'm not bothered about that condition. Another condition within activity four is it should be for business. And I'm availing, Mrs. X is availing these services for personal. So this condition is not met, is not met. That is why it is not at all a supply. If in the present example, there is no consideration. When you check all the conditions, you will take a decision that not at all a supply. But you cannot simply take a decision on the basis of one clause or one activity only. When I have taken the decision, after checking 7-1A, 7-1B, 7-1C, within 7-1C, activity 1, activity 2, activity 3, activity 4, when I checked all the things, then only I wrote these three words that it is not a supply. I hope the point is clear. This is the way to check. Just because some condition is not met in any of the clauses, it doesn't tell me that it is not at all a supply. I need to satisfy all the clauses, all the activities of Schedule 1. Please raise your hand if you understand this exam, if you have understood this exam. That on what basis you are taking the decision, you are reading all the clauses and then you are giving your views that yes, it is not a supply. Please raise your hand if the concept is clear. Prachi, is the concept clear? Yes. Okay, great. Now another example. Let me assume in the same example, let me assume a different point. So now I am telling you that how you should take a decision. Just simply don't say yes or no. Think and then say. Those who say or give their decision without thinking, their decision can be wrong. Also, so apply all the knowledge and then only give your opinion. Example 3. So let me assume another example. So I'm continuing example one. Continuing example one. And do you know what change I will make now? Now I will say that okay, now I am saying that continuing example one, and the change is, there are two changes now. Example one, the changes are, so I'm not continuing example two, I'm continuing example one. The changes are, first, no consideration is given to John. And second is, Mr. John and Mrs. X are related persons under section 15. Are related persons under section 15. I don't know whether you remember or not. In section 15, yesterday I have discussed section 15 relations, related persons. When someone is controlling, when these two people are controlled by third party, when these two people control a single party, when these are members of the same family. So there are so many, there are eight different cases where the two people can be treated as related persons. So I'm assuming that Mr. John and Mrs. X are related persons. Now, same example. And now, same example. Now, can you tell me, is it a supply or no? So the same example is what? This lady, Mrs. X, Delhi, for personal house, she is availing some services from related person, Mr. John, who is in Australia, no consideration. Now can you tell me the answer? Same question. Is it a supply or not? Again, I have the same question. Can you tell me the answer? Is it a supply or not? That's it. Think and decide. Same sequence, 71A, 71B, 71C. Within 71C, activity 1, activity 2, activity 3, activity 4. Now can you tell me the answer? It is not a supply under 71A. One thing is sure, it is not a supply under 71A. Why? Because in 71A, consideration is must, which is missing. Is it a supply in 71B? Is it a supply under 71B? In 71B also, consideration is must, which is missing. Is it a supply in 71C? Within 71C, activity 1. In activity 1, permanent disposal, which is not there. It is not transfer of business assets, okay? It is not transfer of business assets. Activity 2, supply of goods between related persons. Yeah, in activity 2, supply of goods or services or both between related persons is there in the course of business. But business was necessary in activity 2 of schedule 1. I hope you do not remember it because practice is required. Activity 3, principal agent relationship, which is missing. Activity 4, import of services, yes. Consideration not required, but business is also required here, which is missing. And that is why I can say that it is also not a supply. So how I am taking the decision, I am not saying simply yes or no. I am first applying all the clauses and then only I am giving my opinion. Now last example, example 4.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Yugam.
Sir, I wanted to ask that ye example number 3 mein, in activity 4, we said that business is required, right?
Yes.
For import of services or activity in section 7.1c, business is required. But in previous example, no business was not there.
Previous example mein kya? Haan. To agar example nahi hai to main, haan to nahi hai to maine wahan bhi to notice supply likha hua hai.
अच्छा
ठीक है सर, यहाँ बस मैंने एक चेंजेस क्या किया है कि बस ये एडिशनल किया है इसमें.
ठीक है, ओके सर, थोड़ा कंफ्यूजन हो गया था मुझे. थैंक यू सर.
कोई बात नहीं. नाउ एग्जांपल 4. नाउ आई एम कंटिन्यूइंग एग्जांपल 3. अब मैं एग्जांपल 3 को कंटिन्यू करता हूँ. कंटिन्यूइंग एग्जांपल 3, द चेंजेस आर. अब मैं वन में कोई चेंज नहीं कर रहा हूं, वन में तो ऑलरेडी दो चेंज हो चुके हैं, मैं थर्ड में सिर्फ एक चेंज करूंगा. द चेंज इज दैट मिसेज एक्स इज आल्सो इंटीरियर डेकोरेशन इंटीरियर डिजाइनर. दैट मिसेज एक्स वो भी एक कंसल्टेंट है, इज ए कंसल्टेंट. एंड the services which she is importing for interior designing is not for her personal house, is for the house of her client. अब उसके अपने house के लिए नहीं है, उसकी जो consultancy है is for the house of her client. That is the only change. So Mr. John and Mrs. X related, consideration is missing, but Mrs. X is availing the services of interior decoration for the house of her client. Now tell me the question, tell me the answer. Is it a supply or not?
Answer. Sir, it is a supply.
Okay, how? So in 7.1a, it is not a supply. Consideration is missing. In 7.1b, also consideration is required, which is missing. In 7.1c, there are four activities: activity 1, activity 2, activity 3, activity 4. Activity 1 is not there. Activity 2, not there. Why activity 2 cannot be there? Can't be activity 2. Activity 2, let me check activity 2. I'll check activity 2 later. Activity 3 is not there because principal agent. Fourth is what? Is there import of services? Answer is yes. Consideration not required. So it doesn't matter. Is it between related person? Answer is yes. Is it between related person? Answer is yes. Is it for business? Answer is yes. So it is a supply. It is a supply. Do you know under which section? 7.1c, activity 4. Point clear or not? Unmute and reply.
Yes,
is it clear that it is a supply under 7.1c activity 4?
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Sir, in activity 2,
yes,
we wrote a point of employer-employee. Why can't this be considered as a case of employer-employee? Like, Mr. Six is employing Mr. John from Australia for this particular purpose. Why can't it be taken, sir?
No. Why you are confusing with employer-employee? It's not a case of employer-employee, but these are related person. So we can think whether activity 2 can also be applied or not. But why you are adding this point employer-employee? Why employer-employee is relevant here? Is it mentioned that these are employer and employee?
No, sir.
So I cannot myself assume employer-employee. These are related persons. So they can be employer-employee, they can be members of the same family, etc., etc. So these are related persons. So your question should be that can it be covered under activity 2 of 7.1c or not? Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
All others, have you understood this point? Yugam, have you understood this point that can we check it with activity 2 of 7.1c or not? That we should also try to check it in 7.1c just for our knowledge. Is it fine?
Yes, sir. Only that confusion is taking place right now. I mean, activity 2 is also logically relevant by the concept which we had discussed earlier.
Yeah, so we can also check. There is no problem. Any supply can be covered in 2 or 3 activities also. So what's the problem? Government has simply given us different points. One activity can be covered in 3 points also, so there is no problem. The point is it's a supply, that's it.
Yes, sir, that is clear.
Whether that is a supply of activity 1, activity 2, 7.1b, 7.1a, it doesn't make any sense. Once anything has become a supply, in the entire GST, there is no such concept that is it a supply of 7.1a or 7.1b or 7.1c. Answer is it should be a supply of 7 subsection 1, that's it. Is this point clear? Please raise your hand. It should be a supply. Whether it is a supply of 7.1a, 7.1b, 7.1c doesn't make any sense. It should be a supply. That's it. And any transaction can be covered in 2 points also. It's possible that my activity or transaction is covered under 2 points also. 3 points also doesn't make any sense. But still, let us try to check 7.1b, 7.1c, sorry, 7.1c activity 2. Let us try to check. So this is the activity 2 of schedule 1, 7.1c. Supply of goods or services are both between related persons. So John and Mrs. X are related person. Supply is happening between these two when made in the course of business. So my this example can also be treated as supply under activity 2 also. Yes, my this example will be fitted comfortably under both the activities. So there is no harm in that. So I can say that it is a supply. I have written it is a supply under 7.1c activity 4 as well as I can say activity 2. That's it. Please raise your hand if you have understood the point so that we can proceed to the next subsection of section 7. Please raise your hand if the point is 100% clear. Okay, so let us now discuss another concept. Another section, of course, 7.1a. Now, this is what section 7 is going on, and once I have completed my subsection 1. That means one thing is sure, that I have completed my one concept, that something is supply. Now I should proceed further. That after I have made any activity or transaction as a supply, now what I should do? So my next question is, it is a supply of goods or supply of services? Because until and unless I determine whether it is a supply of goods or supply of services, how can I charge the tax? Because we have different tax rates for different categories of goods or services. goods have different tax rate, services have different tax rate. So I have to take a decision whether something should be treated as supply of goods or something should be treated as supply of services. This decision I have to take. So 7.1a comes into picture now. Next subsection. This is what my 7.1a. And what it says? If certain activities or transactions constitute a supply in accordance with the provisions of subsection 1. So it says that once you have determined that any activity or transaction is a supply as per subsection 1, now they must be treated either as supply of goods or supply of services, and for this take the help of Schedule 2 as referred to in Schedule 2. So let me first show you Schedule 2 and then I will simplify the provisions. Now what Schedule 2 says? This is Schedule 2. This will help me in determining whether some activity or transaction is a goods is to be treated as supply of goods or supply of services. So activities or transactions which shall be treated neither, sorry, it is Schedule 3, Schedule 2. Activities or transactions to be treated as supply of goods or supply of services. Now, for example, take this simple example. If you have given a contract to construct a house of yours to a contractor, contractor says that I will charge 80 lakh rupees. And you will ask that in 80 lakh rupees, what you will include? Contractor is saying that all the material, whether iron, wood, cement, steel plus labor charges. So it's a mix. So this 80 lakh is a mix. It's a supply of goods or services. So that question will arise in my mind, that when the contractor is giving you these services along with the material and taking the consideration of 80 lakh rupees on 80 lakh, how much should be the GST rate chargeable? Because it's a combination of goods as well as services. It's a combination of goods as well as services. So how will you charge? So this Schedule 2 will tell me that such services should be taken as 100% supply of goods or 100% supply of services. Similarly, when you go in any restaurant, you don't get the food only. You get the services of chef who has prepared the food for you. You avail the services of waiter also. You avail the services of that ambience which the restaurant has provided to you. So that is also a mix. The bill which you will pay is having two components technically. Something of the some value will be the goods of cost of goods, and some value will be the charges of services. So it's a mix. So I need to determine whether I should treat it as 100% supply of goods or 100% supply of services. Otherwise, I cannot compute GST. This Schedule 2 will help me. And you can see different headings written in Schedule 2. You can see different headings which are written in Schedule 2. Transfer. When you transfer something, like for example, when you transfer the title in goods, like I have sold my laptop to another person, then government says it is to be treated as supply of goods. Of course, everyone knows. So this is the easiest point which I have discussed with you. But still, it has been written specifically in the Act so that there is no confusion, even 0.1%. Whenever goods are transferred, it has to be taken as supply of goods. But when you do not transfer the goods, you only transfer the right in goods. Like you have the laptop and you are giving this laptop to your friend for 2 months and you are charging 2000 rupees. Then government says when you are transferring the right in goods, then don't take it as supply of goods. It should be treated as supply of services. I hope you have understood. When you give the goods, it's a supply of goods. When you give right in goods, not the goods, though, then it should be treated as 100% supply of services. So similarly, you have so many other points, land and building. Then you have treatment or process. Then you have transfer of business assets. Then you have supply of services. So we have different categories given in Schedule 2, which I will simplify for you. Then you have composite supply. Then you have different examples of supply of goods also. So there are technically 7 headings given in Schedule 2. Simplify these headings for you. So let me share my notepad now so that I can simplify the points. I hope the structure is clear. Simplification that I will tell. So what basically now I am discussing with you, section 718. When something has become supply under section 71, then my next job is to apply 71A, because it will tell me whether that supply is to be treated as 100% supply of goods or 100% supply of services. And one thing you must not forget, that you cannot apply 71A without applying 71, because if something is not at all a supply under section 71, then there is no need to read 71A. I hope the point is clear. When you are reading 71A, that means by default your activity or transaction has become supply. So you should not be having this question in your mind while you are reading section 71A, that something is supply or not. Since that has become a supply already, that is why you are here at 71A. So now today I will discuss the examples of supply of goods. So there are 5 different headings, or there are 5 different cases where a supply must be treated as supply of goods only. So today I will wind up only these 5. First, transfer in title of goods. When you transfer the ownership of the goods, when you transfer the title of the goods, by default it is treated as title of goods, supply of goods. For example, Mr. X, furniture dealer. I went to his shop and purchased furniture. So he has transferred the title of goods, that, for example, I purchased a dressing. So transferring this dressing to me, transferring the ownership of dressing to me, is nothing but supply of goods, on which applicable GST will be charged. Ownership of dressing is transferred. It means title is transferred. Ownership of dressing is charged. Second, when you have transferred the right to use goods, sorry, not transferring the right to use goods, it will become supply of services. I am continuing the same point. It is transferring the title in goods at future date. Transfer the title of goods at future date. with an agreement that ownership will be passed at future date. Now, in the above case, you are transferring the ownership right now. The moment you purchase, ownership is transferred. But there are so many transactions of higher purchase transactions. Where, now for example, car. Maybe ownership of car is given to you after 6 months or 6 years or 3 years. Ownership will be given to you after 3 years. But car is given to you right now. Car is transferred right now, but not the ownership until unless we pay the amount. That is also treated as supply of goods. Whether you have transferred the ownership today, or maybe you are transferring the ownership after some time, in both the cases it is treated as the supply of goods will happen, whether happens today or maybe after some time. But it is not treated as supply of services, it is treated as supply of goods, that is sure. Whether transferring the title in goods today or transferring the title with such an agreement that ownership will be passed at a future date. So government says in both the cases, we will assume that supply of goods will happen. Next. Now third point. Goods which are of business assets. These are transferred. Or permanently disposed of. That means disposed means permanently discarded as a scrap, permanently disposed of under my directions, under the direction of the person who is carrying the business. Then also, this transfer or disposal is nothing but supply of goods. This transfer or disposal is nothing but is to be treated as supply of goods. I am the owner of any shop and I have furniture shop. But now I am saying that to my, or I am selling this furniture in scrap. Then in that case, it is clear that it will be assumed that it is supply of goods. Fourth, when a taxable person, now I am a taxable person, who ceases to be a taxable person, the moment he ceases to be a taxable person, any goods which are business assets, will be assumed that these have been supplied, deemed to be supplied by this person, just before one day, by this person before or immediately before he ceases to be a taxable person. Now what is the meaning of this point? Now person and taxable person both are different. I am a person, I am an individual, I am a person, but am I a taxable person? Answer is no. So who are taxable person? If you remember, we have covered the chapter of registration. Who are taxable person? If I am registered, whether I am registered because of my turnover exceeding limit or because I was compulsory liable, that means under section 22 or 24, this we have discussed in detail. If I am registered because of whatever reason, I am a taxable person. So when a taxable person ceases to be a taxable person, so how can I cease to be a taxable person? Maybe I will surrender my registration. I took voluntary registration earlier and now I will surrender by this voluntary registration. So the moment I surrender, I will become a person only, not taxable person. So government says the moment you become, or the moment your status will be changed from taxable to a person, all the goods which you have, we will assume that you have already supplied those goods. Because since you were taxable person, you must have availed input tax credit also when you have purchased the goods. And now you are saying that you will cease to be a taxable person. Government says no problem. You can cease to be a taxable person if the provisions permit. But whatever stock you have with you, we will assume that all have been sold by you when you were taxable person, so that government will collect the GST in that case. This is the point. Like, for example, I'm leaving to some space blank, leave some space blank. For example, Mr. A was a taxable person till 25th Jan 2021. On 26th Jan, next day, for example, he was not a taxable person. So whatever goods he had, he had in his shop. Goods means business goods. ये नहीं कि अपने घर का सामान उस पर भी टैक्स देगा वो, ओनली बिजनेस गुड्स. ही हैड टिल 25th Jan 2021. गवर्नमेंट सेज दैट वी विल अज्यूम दैट दोज गुड्स हैव बीन सोल्ड बाय यू, सप्लाइड बाय यू. एंड व्हेन दीज गुड्स विल बी अज्यूम दैट सप्लाइड बाय यू, गवर्नमेंट विल कंप्यूट जीएसटी. दैट्स इट. बट देयर इज एन एक्सेप्शन ऑफ दिस रूल. देयर आर टू एक्सेप्शंस. That in one case, government says, even if you cease to be a taxable person, still we will not assume that goods have been supplied by you. What is that exception? First, if the business is transferred as a going concern. That means, if not you, another person, taxable person, is coming now to take over your business. If business is transferred as a going concern basis. Government needs the tax, that's it. So if you are transferring your business, so the moment you transfer the business, you cease to be a taxable person, but maybe another person is taking over the business, who is a taxable person? The government says, no problem. In that case, we will not assume that the goods have been supplied by you, because the goods have become part of another person who will supply it later on. So government says, in that case, we will not assume that goods have been supplied by you. If the business is transferred as a going concern, not as a shutdown business. And second, if business is carried on by your personal representative, by your representative, who will be assumed to be the taxable person? Now suppose a person has become of old age, who was the businessman and taxable person. So he appointed his friend, for example, to take charge of this business. So in that case, government says there's no issue. Your friend will be assumed to be a tax sale person, and we will not assume that the goods have been supplied by you before you cease to be a tax sale person. This is my point four. And the last point is, when goods are transferred by association to its members, when goods are transferred by an association to its members, now we have so many housing cooperative societies. Okay, so we have cooperative societies. Now what, so many times what cooperative societies can do, maybe to save electricity in their society, they wanted to distribute LED bulbs or tube lights to the members, at less prices. In that case, this supply is also treated as supply of goods. Supplying LED bulbs is also treated as supply of goods. That's it. So today I have winded up section 7.1a, five cases where the supply will always be treated as supply of goods by default. I hope the point is clear. In case you have any problem, you can ask me. Otherwise, let us end the session. Goodbye.